back, there was a great preacher by the name of Leonard Ravenhill. And he used to tell a story in his preaching. He was from over in Great Britain, and I can't even make a joke, but Margaret's not back yet. But he was from Great Britain, and he knew the countryside well. And this group of tourists were visiting one of these little picturesque villages. When you think of England and Scotland, and you know, you can just picture this little village in the and this tour group comes through, and they decided that they were going to ask this old man on the street a question. And in a rather patronizing way, one of the tourists says, "Were any great men born in this village?" And the old man replied, "Nope, only babies." It's a pretty profound answer to a pretty patronizing question, but you know, there's some truth in it. You know, in this world of instant everything, there are no instant heroes. You don't just turn into an instant great person. And we like to put everything in the microwave, and a minute from now it's going to be done, and I'm going to eat. And we like to have everything at our fingertips. You know, we just pull our phone out of our pockets and we have instant access to things. But there is no instant access to being a hero. Some people, they may have advantages. They may have a head start with how they're brought up and what they have at their disposal. But I want you to think of this. Even the Savior of the world, even Jesus Christ, started his life as a baby. In the same way that we all start our lives. You know, I was thinking about this and the utmost importance that's placed on the topic of Christian maturity by Paul in the church. You know, last week I told you that there were two things that Paul really wanted to urge the church in Ephesus to focus on and to really look at. And last week we talked about Paul saying how important unity was in the church. And I told you that we'd continue this week. The second thing that Paul brings up is the importance of Christian maturity. Without maturity, you know and I know, the church can be downright childish at times. As a father of three, I have a number of ways of looking at the maturity of our children. How many of you have the lines on the doorpost or the lines on, we have a bunk bed that we have the lines drawn every so often, you know, every few months the kids go up and we mark their line on the bed to see how tall that they're getting. That's a way that we mark maturity with them. Or we assign ages to them. The kids are, you know, kids are always excited to get to that next birthday and to reach the next mark. And we even have different responsibilities that we give to the kids based on what they can handle. But what are the measures, what are the things that we can look at when it comes to the maturity of our faith and the maturity of our Christian walk? Is it doesn't just seem that the passing of time automatically leads to growing in maturity spiritually. We need some specific work at it if we're ever going to obtain all that Paul is talking about when it comes to Christian maturity. As he continues on in the fourth chapter of Ephesians, and you can turn there in your Bible, Paul lays out a clear path for us about how to take hold of the mature faith that is yours. We're going to start in verse 7, Ephesians 4, verse number 7. And it says this, "But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. This is why it says, when he ascended on high, he took many captives and gave gifts to his people. What does he ascended mean except that he also descended to the lower earthly regions? He who descended is the very one who ascended higher than all the heavens in order to fill the whole universe. So Christ himself gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, and the teachers to equip his people for works of service, so that the body of Christ may be built up, until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the full measure of the fullness of Christ. Then we will no longer be infants tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by cunning and craftiness of people and their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become in every respect the mature body of Him who is the head, that is Christ. From Him the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. You see, God has a desire and God has a plan for each one of us to reach our full potential, to reach our full maturity in the faith. But how do we obtain it? How do we get further down the road than we are today? Before we go any further, let's ask the Lord to bless our time. Andy, would you open us in prayer this morning?
Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you for your love and your blessings that you bestow upon one of us. Lord, just open up our minds and our hearts to your message and your words in your precious name.
Amen. So the first thing in our scripture that I see is that God gives us gifts to allow us to attain maturity. God gives us gifts to allow us to attain maturity. When you think of grace, what's the first thing that comes to mind? Just yell it out.
Mia.
Mia, because that's her middle name. Mia Grace. What else?
Mercy.
Jesus.
Mercy, Jesus. How many of you think of the song we just sang during worship, Amazing Grace? When I hear that word, I automatically go back to the song. We think of grace, we think of the forgiveness of our sins. And we boil it down to these few things, but grace is so much bigger than we make it out to be. I mean, we know how great grace is, and we know how it has to be great to cover over all of our sins. But grace is the charis of God. What does that mean? It means any time that God shows us favor, we're receiving grace. Because God doesn't have to show us favor, but He does anyway. It means that every time we are shown a kindness by God, that we are receiving grace. Any time that we receive a blessing from God, we're receiving grace. Anytime God shows us gratitude or thanksgiving, or anytime God shows us forgiveness, we are experiencing the charis of God. And a huge part of this is the forgiveness of sin, but I want to look back to our scripture to see what it tells us about how we receive the grace and the charis of God when it comes to maturity. It says this, starting in verse 7. But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. That is why it says, when He ascended on high, He took many captives and gave gifts to His people. What does He ascended mean except that He also descended to the lower earthly regions? He who descended is the very one who ascended higher than all the heavens in order to fill the whole universe. Now, there's been a lot of people give a lot of teaching on what these verses mean, and it goes on for hours, let me tell you. You can research this, and you can look into it deeper. But I want to take this out of this just simple little truth. Jesus went to great lengths to give His people gifts. And He went and He took captive all anything that could stand against Him giving you the things that He wanted to give you. Meaning that He went up into heaven to do that. He went into the earth to do that. And anyone who, or anything that stood against Him giving gifts to His people, He took captive. So what are these gifts? These are the spiritual gifts that are mentioned all throughout Scripture. So God has given each one of us a spiritual gift or spiritual gifts that allow us to function in God's kingdom. Paul elaborates more on this in 1 Corinthians 12. He says, there are different kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit distributes them. There are different kinds of service, but the same Lord. There are different kinds of working, but in all of them and in everyone is the same God at work. Now to each one, the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good. So everyone is given different gifts for the common good of the church. And what do these include? Well, Romans 12, it lists the gifts of exhortation. It lists the gifts of giving, the gifts of leadership, the gifts of mercy, the gifts of prophecy, the gift of service, the gift of teaching. All listed in Romans 12. In 1 Corinthians 12, you get the gift of administration, the gift of apostleship, the gift of discernment, the gift of faith, the gift of healings, of helps, of knowledge, miracles, prophecy, teaching, tongues, interpretation of tongues, and wisdom. All of those are listed, 1 Corinthians 12. If we keep reading on in Ephesians chapter 4, we'll find the gift of apostleship, evangelism, pastoring, prophesying, wisdom, teaching. And in other scriptures, you have gifts of hospitality and the gift of being a missionary. There's a lot of gifts, folks. But you first have to find out what is yours. Because if you do not know your gift, it'll be like picking straws. You'll be like, okay, let's try this. Or, well, I don't know, how about we try this? You need to find the gift that the Lord has given you. So how can you do that? One way, go online, type in spiritual gifts inventory. It'll pop up a test. You know, kids like to take these tests online nowadays. But it'll pop up a test, you'll fill out a few questions, and it'll pop back and say, your gift is fill in the blank, and it'll tell you. Easy. If you like it the old-fashioned way, I have one sitting on my desk. You can fill it out, it's on paper. You can fill it out, and it'll tell you rank your top three and your bottom three. Or you can just look at it this way. What are you passionate about? What do you like to do? Because God knit you together while you were in your mother's womb. And so He gave you your desires and your talents and all of the things that make you you. And use that to find out, well, I can look at that. And I can look at those gifts that are listed. And I can see that, well, I can pick out a few that probably appeal to me. Whatever it is, we need to find our gifts because they will lead us into maturity. And that's the first part of the equation. The second thing is, you have to use your gift. You have to use it. You know, think about when you have a kid that is opening a present at Christmas time. And they're opening or on their birthday, and they open up the gift. And just about every time they open the gift, what's their reaction? Yeah! But you know how you can really tell they like their gift? They keep using it. 2 days later, it's not sitting on a shelf that, you know, where they went yay at first. And a few years ago, we got Addison, I don't know, I think Santa Claus got it, a Flutterby doll. And I made it chase her around the house, and she never used it again, even though that's what she really wanted. She hated that thing. But I've seen kids pick up the box and play with the box for months on end until the bottom breaks out. You use the things that you really like and that you're really grateful for. And God has given each of us these wonderful gifts that He did not have to give us. Salvation alone was enough. But on top of that, He gave us all of these gifts, and we show our gratefulness in how we use them. And we show our maturity by how often we use them. You know, if you're working outside of your gifts, you'll never grow. You always stay in the same place. But when you start functioning in the church, in your gifts, you will begin to flourish. So God has given us gifts to lead us to maturity. The second thing, God has given us leaders to attain maturity. I was reading an article the other day on the reasons that millennials are not attending churches. And if you don't believe the article, look around. There's not a lot of millennials here or anywhere in church, just a few. And the article was composed of things that I expected to see, but the very end of the article, the last reason that they gave was this. Millennials are not coming to church because of the lack of mentoring that takes place between leaders and the younger people in the congregation. That blew my mind. The millennial generation has taken its fair share of hits throughout the years and from seemingly every other generation. But they were spot on in their assessment of the church because they recognized the importance of having someone to pour into your life. Someone who has been there before you, someone that knows the ropes, and someone that can pull you along. They've seen the need for someone to help them along the way. And Paul thought the same thing. If you're going to be mature, you have to put yourself at the feet of a leader and learn from their words and their behavior. This is what it says from the scripture this morning. It says, "So Christ himself gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, and the teachers to equip his people for works of service, so that the body of Christ may be built up, until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the full measure of the fullness of Christ. Then we will no longer be infants, tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of people and their deceitful scheming." You see, some of the people have the gifts of leadership, the gifts of teaching, the gifts of prophecy, and these people are expected to lead all of the other people in their gifts into maturity. Basically, they're talking about having a group of mature believers who are able to mentor the next generation. And the main job of these pastors and evangelists and prophets and apostles, the main job of these people is not to grow the church. Their main job is not to preach the sermon on Sunday. According to Paul, their main job is to build up the ones who are less mature in the faith. Their main duty is to focus on those who are not mature and to make them get that way. So we need to find the leaders who are doing this in a biblical, sound manner and learn from them. You know, there are far too many people in this world that want to be the Lone Ranger Christian. They want a faith like Burger King, where they can have it their way. Amen? And I'm talking about me, and I'm talking about all of us. Where we just want to do things at our pace and let other people kind of butt out of it, okay? But the truth is, we learned last week that we're meant to exist in a united church. And that's, you can't be a solo in a united church. You are united to the rest of the body. And so we need these people that we can gain knowledge from. We need these people who we can gain correction from. What happens to a child when correction leaves? What do they become? A brat. That's the exact word I was thinking of. So, if you do not have someone providing correction for you while you are growing up in the Christian faith, you are a brat. I'm just telling you, letting you know. We need these people to move us on to maturity. This is what Jesus said in Luke 6. It says, he also told them this parable. Can the blind lead the blind? will they not both fall into a pit? The student is not above the teacher, but everyone who is fully trained will be like their teacher. So what it's saying, Jesus is saying, is find someone who you want to be like, and follow them and listen to them and have them in your lives. Because if you ever want to be greater than yourself, you have to have a quality teacher. Or two teachers. Or three teachers. You need to submit yourself to their mentoring, to their advice, to their correction, so that they can mold you into someone greater than yourself. That's how you gain on to maturity. So God has given us leaders to attain maturity. God has given us a mission to achieve maturity as well. Let's look back at our scripture. Paul says, instead, speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become in every respect the mature body of Him who is the head, that is Christ. From Him the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. So Paul has already told us that the reason that we follow the leaders that God has put us in place here is to prepare us for works of service. And if we go back to chapter 2 of Ephesians, we remember that God has created us to do certain good works, which He prepared in advance for us to do. And here we see the church coming together as each part partakes in the good works by doing their part. So are you starting to see a theme? Christian maturity involves you committing yourself and doing God's mission here on earth through good works and good service. And that leads to maturity. You know, those who are mature know that good deeds and faith go hand in hand. And James wrote this. He said, but some will say, you have faith and I have deeds. Show me your faith without deeds, and I will show you my faith by my deeds, said James. A mature faith is one that always is made up of good deeds and good works in the church, and it's not just made up of good works. You see, there's no room to sit on the bench as a Christian. You know, in high school, I spent a lot of time sitting on benches on various sports teams. It's not any fun on the bench, is it? I didn't have any fun there, and the only thing that got me off of the bench was working harder and trying harder and getting better so that I could actually go out on the field and play, and then I didn't have to sit on the bench, because the bench is no fun. There's no action there. It's really boring, and it's really cold. We need to get our faith and put it into action. Because the bench is full anyhow. We need people who will walk in their faith into the good deeds that God has prepared them to do. Too often we think that Christian maturity is about how much knowledge that we attain. How much knowledge that we put into our brain. But I found that maturity is two parts. It's what we learn, and then it's what we do with what we learn. And we keep stepping on. We learn something new, and we do with what we learn by putting it into good deeds. How many of you have been to Climax to see the Eagles nest? Anybody been down that way? Or how many of you have watched the Eagles as they hatch on the webcam and everything? I anticipated there was a few of you. And when you look at the eagle nest, what do you focus on? The little eagles. Okay, the little eagles and the big eagle, those are the stars of the ship. But you know what? The nest is really interesting. You see, the mother eagle, when she builds her nest, she starts with thorns and broken branches and sharp rocks, and anything that is uncomfortable that you can think of. You don't often see that in the eagle's nest. And then she takes and lines the nest with thick paddings of wool and feathers and fur from animals, and she makes it soft and comfortable and puts it over top of all of the uncomfortable things. And when the growing birds reach flying age, the comfort of the nest and the free meals that they receive from mom make them quite reluctant to leave. Kind of like the millennials. And so that's when the mother eagle starts stirring up the nest. She starts taking off layers of wool and fur and feathers. With her strong talons, she starts scraping up the bottom until the nest becomes uncomfortable for the young eagles. And eventually, this causes them to leave the comfort of the nest because it's not so comfortable anymore and move on to more mature behavior. I wonder what would happen if the pews had spike strips in them. You know, that we could just raise and lower if we needed to. I'm only joking about this, but it would be cool. But most of us have allowed ourselves to become so comfortable in church in our regular lives that we don't want to move on to the next level of maturity. I've gone far enough. How many of you have said that? I've gone far enough. I don't need to go any further. I'm good. But we need to spread our wings. You know, we have a father eagle that's telling us that we are capable of flying. And we're content with sitting. We need to find out the gifts that He has given us, embrace them, and make sure that we're using them. We need to make sure that we have someone who is pouring in facts and knowledge and goodness into our lives, and we're putting it into practice. And we need to be doers of the Word and not just hearers only. Can you imagine a church full of people who are united together and who are fully mature? Because that's the vision that Paul had for the church at Ephesus. And it should be our goal as well. So what are you doing to make sure you're gaining in maturity and not just gaining in years? You know, we all start out as babes in the faith. But thank God we don't all end that way. The choice is yours. Will you be someone great and allow God to mold you into who He wants you to be? Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we thank You for Your Word. Lord, we thank You that we're not just meant to be helpless babes, but Lord, that You have made a way for us to step out in faith and to become and grasp our maturity. That each day that we can grow closer to You, and each day that we can become more like You. Lord, last week we prayed that we would become a united body. And this week, Lord, our prayer is that we would become a united and a mature body of believers. Lord, we just thank You for Your Word. And it's in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen.
Let us stand and close the song. I need.
Walk in it in all of your maturity. You are dismissed. Have a great week in the Lord.